You know, today we're privileged to have a speaker with us who has come 8,000 miles. How far have you come? Yes, yes. That is just to get here. She's got 8,000 miles to go home. She's from Ibadan, Nigeria. Did I say Ibadan right, Bosede? Ibadan. That's a small city of maybe 2.5-3 million people, I'm guessing. Bigger than that, maybe. Nigeria is a country of 173 million people, so it's not a small place. Our speaker was a flourishing attorney. Now, why would someone who had a flourishing law practice and had to come 8,000 miles, but why would someone turn and be here today? She started out by being introduced to the book Science and Health with Keys to the Scriptures by Mary Bakarey. That apparently touched her because it changed her life. Changed a lot of other people's lives too. So there was that moment right there. There was another moment when she decided to go into the public practice of Christian Science and leave her law practice. To some friends and family, it sounds like that didn't make much sense. They weren't very encouraging, I might add. She got a call at some point to be a lecturer, to come to Boston to work on that and to practice that. She's a teacher of Christian Science. She has come here. All of these moments have come together for this talk today because she loves God, and quite frankly, she loves you and everyone that she comes in contact with. She's got a family. She has three boys. I know one lives in Austin, Texas, and he's in IT. His wife teaches Sunday school down there. She has experience. She's going to talk about a spiritual approach to healthcare and a certainty of healing. You're going to hear a message that you're going to like, you're going to enjoy, and it's going to change your lives. Please welcome Bosede Bakarey.
Joy to be here and to see so many people gathered because of this important mission of Christian Science. I've always felt, even before a nurse became president of the Mother Church, that what will save this movement is the nursing. Many people run into trouble. They can call practitioners. But how about the physical needs? Who's going to perform that? Many of them end up in hospitals. We're so grateful to have a place like this. And I'm staying right here, and I tell you, it's been wonderful. Peaceful, loving. I could feel the presence of the Christ here. I'm happy to be the speaker today on spiritual approach to healing. I always say to people that there is only one approach that I know really works. And that's the Christian Science approach. Today, the world is asking, is there anything that is so effective that we can rely on to find complete and permanent healing? If you have a headache today and you go to the doctor, no doctor will tell you you're not going to have headache again all your life. Does anyone tell you that? No, they tell you, please come back when it comes back. But Christian Science is so precise. It's a healing. And this healing is effective. And it is permanent. I've proved it time and time again in my own life, in my children's lives, for the community, for people. And I know it's so effective and reliable. One thing people have always wanted to find is a reliable method of healthcare. Many are asking, Is there a spiritual approach to healthcare, a practical science of divine truth that can heal all kinds of illnesses and discord? Is there anything like that? Is there anything else that can do that? I haven't found it. I've found only Christian science to be reliable and effective. You don't have to do any research other than studying your Bible and science and health. So if today you're sick, tired, poor, unemployed, can you see how wide Christian science can go? Do you go to a doctor when you need employment? Do you go to a doctor when you need money? No. Christian science is the only religion that covers every aspect of life. No matter what the world is saying about you today, whatever, no matter what you're going through right now, let me assure you, your situation is not hopeless. You will find healing, certain healing. Christian science heals with scientific certainty. But a lot of people want to know, what is Christian science? How many of us know what Christian science is? I've asked Christian scientists and they couldn't explain what Christian science is. What is Christian science? People are easily say, oh, I'm a Christian scientist. What is Christian science?
The law of God practiced.
The law of God
practiced.
What else?
The science of Christianity.
That's a little bit complicated. If you bring science into Christianity, can you explain it?
Science is demonstrating through logical premise and logical.
That's too complicated. Please. Christian science.
A way of life.
Yeah?
A way
of life. Love. Truth. I mean, if you want to introduce Christian science to someone who's never heard of it before, are you just going to say, it's the law of God? And they say, oh, do I have to go to law school to know this law? I think a lot of Christian scientists are not awake enough. You need to wake up to know how to explain Christian science to the market woman, someone who is not educated. When you're talking about demonstration, scientific thing, are you not complicating issues? You want to explain it in the simplest way possible. Christian science is the law of God that Christ Jesus came to teach us and to practice. The word Christian, what is the word Christian? What does it mean? That we are following Christ Jesus, following in his footsteps, and that we're devoted to him. You ask yourself, am I really following Christ Jesus? You need to ask yourself, am I a Christian? Are you doing what Jesus would do? You should ask yourself, in every situation, what would Jesus do? Ask yourself. Some time ago, I met someone who had a clip on, and the lady said, had this clip which said, WWJD. Then I asked her, what does that mean? She said, I don't know. I bought it from my church. WWJD. What does that mean? What would Jesus do? What would Jesus do in this situation? What did he do? When he saw the sick, what did he do? He healed them. When he saw the hungry, he fed them. He went about doing good. If you are not going about doing good, you are not a Christian. You are not following the examples of Jesus Christ. You don't have to wear the flowing gown to be a Christian, to be a follower of Christ Jesus. A friend of mine recently visited Jerusalem, and when she came, she's not a Christian scientist, she said, "Oh, that was a great experience. I put my feet in the mold." I said, "Which mold?" "Actually, I was following the steps of Christ, you know. I went into the mold. I put my feet there." "Is that how you follow your Christ?" Do you act Jesus? Or do you demonstrate the Christ? To be a Christian is to demonstrate the Christ. To prove that you're a child of God. To do exactly what Jesus did. But the place where people really get annoyed with us, what has science got to do with Christianity? So when you say scientific and everything, you're just complicating matters. What does that word science mean? What does it mean? What does that word science mean? Science. If you go to your dictionary, it says understanding. The understanding of Christianity. The demonstrable understanding of Christianity, practical Christianity. That's what the science means. It's not any big word. But because most of us don't know how to use a dictionary, we just believe we know. "Oh, what is science?" "I do, I know what it is." "No, no, don't ask me. I know it. You don't need to tell me that. I know it." The word science indicates that which can be proved and which is consistent and certain. It's that understanding that can be demonstrated, the understanding of the Christ. And what is this Christ? Christ heals, Christ saves, Christ does this, and we're about saying that. "Oh, I'm a Christian. Oh, Christ does this, does that." What has that got to do with you? What has it got to do with you? We'll get to that. What is health? What is health?
Wholeness.
Completeness. Freedom. Harmony. Mary Baker Eddy, the discoverer and founder of Christian Science, answers this question in her book, Science and Health, with key to the scriptures. "The basis of all health, sinlessness and immortality is the great fact that God is the only mind, and that this mind must not merely be believed, but it must be understood." From this statement, we may draw the conclusion that the whole process of acquiring, restoring, or maintaining health is based on the understanding of God. And that's why Jesus said, "Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." Do you know the truth?
Yes.
How many people have investigated the word know? K-N-O-W. What does it mean? Understand. You will understand the truth, and the truth that you understand will set you free. So it is understanding that heals. You need to gain the understanding of God and man. Ms. Sedi says in her book, Science and Health, she says, "As mortals gain correct views of God and man, multitudinous objects of creation, which before were invisible, will become visible." You need to gain the correct view. You need to gain the understanding of God and man. You need to know who you are. Who am I? What am I? We need to understand the nature of God, because this understanding is what brings healing. The Bible has many stories of men and women who were able to overcome hopeless situations. They were healed, they succeeded, they found good. Their characters were transformed because they trusted God's promises. Do you trust God's promises?
Yes.
The Bible is full of God's promises. But a lot of us, when we get into situations, that trust disappears. We start to fret. Can God really help me in this situation? What am I going to do? You need to build your confidence in God's goodness. You need to start to trust God absolutely. You need it. We all need it. In Exodus, we read, I will take sickness away from the midst of thee, and I'm the Lord that healeth thee. God is the only healer. You don't need to help God. You don't need to assist him. I'm so grateful for the nurses who confront all these situations. I'm sure if I was to be a nurse, I don't think I would be useful. Yeah, because, you know, when you're faced with the real, it's so easy to call a practitioner and say, oh, I'm praying with you. Okay, call me back later, you know. It's so easy. It's very simple. The practice is, I'm not saying it's too simple, but I tell you, those who are really facing, like the lady who was confronted with the bleeding, you know, can you imagine? Many practitioners would faint. Yeah, it's so different. So that's why I really appreciate the work of the nurses. I'm so grateful for what you're doing. Because you are really on the scene. You're there, seeing everything. I remember one of my patients, my students who went into nursing. She got so scared. And then she called. I think I'm going to stop this nursing thing. Because many times when I go through and I meet patients and the situations are so terrible, I can't sleep. You know, I'm so afraid. And I said, you better pack it up. You are not fit for that job. Some people cannot even stand the sight of blood. So what are you saying? For those who face it fearlessly, we need to salute their courage. About 2,000 years ago, Jesus said, ye shall know the truth. Understand the truth. And the truth you understand will make you free. You need to understand the truth. Jesus understood the truth. He knew the truth about God and about himself. And this understanding helped him to heal what others could not heal. In her book, Science and Health, Mary Baker Eddy says, God is incorporeal, divine, supreme, infinite mind, spirit, principle. This is the God that was expressed in Jesus Christ. He went about expressing the Christ. But we need to understand the difference. Because in my country, many churches preach that Jesus is God. And just last week, I was giving a talk on the radio, and someone called in and said, what do you mean that Jesus is not God? He's God to us. This is what you're saying is nonsense. I don't believe in you. And I said, I'm not here to argue with you. Jesus never said he was God. Did he say he was God? No. But we need to understand that relationship. Christ and Jesus. Jesus the man, Christ the divine ideal. Jesus the way sure, Christ the way. How do we understand that Christ is the way? How do we demonstrate that? Christ is the way. We all say it. Christ is the way. Christ is the way. How do we demonstrate that? The way to what? Yes, it's the way. It means Christliness. Christ-likeness is the way to health. When you're Christ-like in your thoughts, in your words, and in your deeds, you will heal and be healed. Christliness. You need to be Christ-like in everything you're doing. you would do what Jesus did. What would Jesus do in this situation? When you follow that, you would see that nothing can stop you from demonstrating the Christ. Jesus was able to heal with scientific certainty. There was never a situation when he said, how long have you had this ailment? Oh, 18 years. You better go home and die. Oh, this is hopeless. I can't help you. Even the man at the Bethesda pool, 38 years, he didn't say, oh, this has gone on for too long. I'm sorry. You just have to die. And so in our approach to Broadview, what are you here for? Your expectation, someone mentioned the expectation, you know. What are you expecting? Healing, you must expect to be healed. You don't dump your people here to die. That's what Christian Science Nursing is turning to. A lot of people, once they get here, they think, oh, this is... Some family members start to cry. I say, oh, we won't see you again. I don't think that is right. Your situation, no matter how bad it looks now, is not hopeless. You will certainly find healing. Christian Science heals. You need to expect healing. The Bible says in Jeremiah, I know the thoughts that I think towards you, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. Ask yourself, what am I expecting from here? Are you expecting healing? If you are not, you better change your thoughts now. You must be healed. That's what I tell some of my patients. Some of them, oh, I think it's God's will. I said, God's will? You have to start affirming the truth about yourself, knowing that nothing can stop you from being healed. Nothing, nothing. Only mortal mind tells you you've come to the end. No, don't accept that. Don't listen to that. Whose report are you going to believe? Doctor's report or God's report? God's report is good. That's what you should believe. Jesus showed us how to overcome challenging situations. He exercised the Christ power. Healing in Christian Science means waking up. Healing is waking up. It means waking up to the infinite goodness of God and to man's rich blessings as his beloved son. It means waking up from the dark dreams of sin, sickness, fear, and grief that haunt mortal life. It means waking up to our God-bestowed freedom from evil of every sort. Healing is not a miracle. People say, oh, I'm expecting my miracle. No. Christian Science healing is never a miracle. Do you know the meaning of miracle? Supernatural. But healing in Christian Science is supremely natural. So it's not a miracle. Don't expect a miracle. Expect good. Healing is not miracle, but supremely natural. As we begin to better understand God, Christ Jesus' teachings, the Bible, and Mary Baker Eddy's writings, we begin to see or understand that the healings that seem to be miracles are really just the result of our understanding and applying laws that have always been there, laws based on spirit, not on matter. That's why the Bible counsels, with all you're getting, get understanding. Understanding is what heals you. Understanding is what changes your thought. An improved belief can never retrograde. Once your thought has changed, then your healing is certain. Jesus was able to see through. You know, he didn't see physicality. He didn't see mortality. He saw the perfect man of God's creating. And it's this scene that transformed every situation he was involved in. When it's very close to home, It's difficult to see perfection. I can tell you that. It's so difficult to see perfection. And that's why when I think about nurses, I'm very grateful, you know? When I'm working for my own children, it's so difficult because right before my eyes, I think of the evils they've done. I remember all the things and I sometimes feel, I think this guy deserves to suffer. So you can see that, you know, and that's why I don't take my children's cases. Go look for your practitioner because I can't seem to go past. It's been very difficult for me, particularly when I'm praying for a child who keeps on misbehaving, you know. I'll be patient for some time. I keep affirming, oh, he's a perfect child of God. He's good. But I say, this guy is not good. That's why it's so difficult. You know all the things they are doing. And you're saying to yourself, how can this one have a healing? I think you've got to change. You've got to change so many things. But that's not the true healing. So I don't even bother again. I tried it for several times and I realized I'm not getting anywhere with these children, you know? Because this is a guy, a young man I'm praying for about a particular thing. And he comes doing exactly the same thing. And then he tells me, see me right. I say, what do I want to see you right for? You're not doing what is right. So how can I see you right? And that's why I always, when I've had patients who came to me with their husbands, with their wives, I would always say, can you let your wife see me alone? Please. Because most of the time, I had someone who came to see me. And this man, because they were French speaking, the wife couldn't even speak French. He was trying to explain to me what the wife had. And so I said, I don't think I want to hear you. She's an adult. I'd like to speak to her again. Let someone else come with her and explain to me what she's really going through. And then she came with someone else. You know what she told me? That man is my problem. So I said, I knew. I suspected that, you know. I suspected that. So she explained to me what the man... He was a practitioner. Or he's still a practitioner. But he kept explaining to me what someone has done to his wife. So I said, you just let this woman come alone. I don't want you around. Can you let her come back alone? And I said, okay. But I think I can explain her problem more. She said, this man that came with me, that's my problem. It's the cause of everything happening to me. You know, and then we had to work it out and she got healed. The man said he had been working for her for so long. I've been trying to heal this woman. How could he? When he's the cause of the problem, how could he? So it's always advisable. That's what I do. I tell people, please, your wife, your husband is an adult. Please don't come with them. Or if you come with them, you've got to excuse us when she needs to talk to me so that she can talk freely. It's very important that you keep that sense, you know, to keep the confidentiality. Jesus didn't accept sickness as real. In healing the woman who was bowed together, what did he do? What did he say to her? He didn't say, straighten up. He didn't say, oh, arise and walk. What did he say to her?
Woman, thou art loosed.
Thou art loosed from thine infirmity. What is infirmity? Inability to take a firm stand. She was unable to take a firm mental stand for her spiritual perfection. She had to learn to do that. Many of us have to do that. We need to take the firm mental stand for our spiritual perfection. Know who you are as a child of God. That right now, you're a child of God. You're spiritual. You're perfect. Infirmity is inability to take a firm mental stand for our spiritual perfection. Because all who came to Jesus found healing. All who managed to get to Jesus, all who came. But today, there is no Jesus again. So what do? Do we go to Jerusalem to find healing? No. We need to investigate the word come. How do we come to Jesus today? We have a hymn which says, oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. How can we come to Jesus today? What's the meaning of the word come? How do you come to the Christ today? We all know that some of us would know, and I think many of us do know, the story of the prodigal. The Bible says he had spent all the father had given him. He was now in want. That's Luke. And then he came to himself. How do we come to ourselves? To realize our true selfhood. What, I'm a child of God? What am I doing here? My father is rich. Whether it is sickness, lack, whatever you're confronting today, all you have to do is to come to the Christ, and that is to come to yourself, your real self, to realize your true selfhood, to wake up. That was an awakening for the prodigal. Had the father gone to meet him, I'm sure the father might have known where he was. If the dad had gone there and said, oh, my son, come home, said, I hate you, Dad. I don't want to come home with you. But until he came to himself, that spiritual awakening, he woke up. What am I doing in this situation? So whatever you're going through today, wake up. Come to your true selfhood. Realize your true selfhood. What, I'm a child of God? What am I doing here? I'm spiritual. I'm perfect. We all need it. Spiritual awakening. Miss Eddie says, science reveals the possibility of achieving all good and set mortals at work to discover what God has already done. Divine love meets every need, not want. There's a difference between need and want. Instead, it says in Science and Health also, it is our ignorance of God, the divine principle, which produces apparent discord. And a right understanding of Him restores harmony. What is ignorance? Lack of understanding. That's it. Lack of understanding. So you need to come to the Christ today to wake up to your true identity. It's an individual thing. You don't, oh, let's come to Christ together. No, it's never done together. It's in your corner. It's something that happens within you. He said he was able to prove this in her own experience. She was able to rise up from sickness. And she was healed by waking up. We all need to wake up to our true identity. And that's what will help us. She gave the parable of the woman who had lost a coin and had to sweep her whole house looking for that coin. And when she found it, she rejoiced. That is what we need to do with our Christianity. Many of us seem to have lost that healing. Christian Science seems to be losing that healing. Many of us support it with something. Oh, I think I can just take a pill here. No problem. That's not going to help. I'm just going to continue to work. Don't worry. Just let me take that one. If you don't believe that thing is going to work for you, you won't take it at all. You need to be absolutely sure that God heals and He will heal you. If there's a challenge that you have today, you can work with the definition of man on page 475. And it's not what is man. It's what am I? What am I? Sometimes you have to put your name there. What am I? I'm not matter. I'm not brain, bone, blood, all the material elements. And when you are declaring this truth, make sure you are declaring with understanding. It's not mere words. That won't help you. The mission of the Christ is to reveal the true nature of God to us, and that we are the likeness of spirits. Therefore, not flesh and blood, but wholly spiritual. You are completely spiritual. Spirit is the only truth about you. Misery is so clear about that. He says, look away from the body. Most of us are so focused on the body, and that's why we're not getting healings, you know? Many times, oh, let me look at it. Oh, has this thing improved? Particularly if it's somewhere you can see. Oh, I know some patients have come to me telling me, can I just show you where that thing is? And I say, please don't. No, just so that you can know how the severity of it. I say, please save me that problem. Please don't. I know the truth about you, and I'm going to hold on to that. It's so tempting to be focused on the body. It seems to have sensation. It seems to tell us everything. But Miseri says, look away from the body. The fact is, our true spiritual selfhood or identity, our oneness with God, remains a perfect being. We are not both spiritual and material. You are wholly spiritual with no material aspects. This was what Jesus proved. The truth that spiritual man has forever been God's immortal idea and therefore perfect was the basis of Jesus' healing works. His clear understanding and the power and perfection of God and of the spiritual perfection and wholeness of God's image and likeness, man, was sufficient to destroy any form of sickness. That's what we need to understand. If you point to this material body and say, is this not me? Is this you? No. The real you cannot be seen. The real you, the thinking, living you, is God's idea. You are God's expression. Spirit is all. You are your thought. That's why Shakespeare says, as the Bible says it, as he thinketh in his heart, so he is. All who came to the Christ found healing. You can come to the Christ today, can't you? You don't need to go to Jerusalem. You just need to wake up to your true identity. How did Jesus heal? Many researchers are finding that the thoughts of a man actually determines his experience. And that's why Jesus several times would ask his disciples, how thinketh thee? What are you thinking? You know, are you thinking spiritually or materially? The slogan of Toyota is good thinking, good products. That's the slogan of Toyota. And I can tell you, their cars are good. So the cars have come from good thinking. So when you think correctly, your product will be correct, will be perfect. The Bible says, righteousness exalteth a nation. What is righteousness? Right thinking. That's righteousness. Right thinking. So if righteousness can exalt a nation, what would it do to man? Wouldn't it transform your life? When Jesus began his ministry, he said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent. That word repent means change your thought. Change your thinking. The Bible says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Transformation of thought and experience. Shakespeare says there is nothing either good or bad. Thinking makes it so. So you can see the power of thought. No matter what the situation is, if you can think correctly, that's why Miseri says, the time for thinkers has come. Not for singers, not for clappers, not for dancers. I was giving a talk to a group of youth in Nigeria, and they asked me, you know, Christian Science is so boring. We want to be able to clap and dance and sing. And I said, there are several churches around where you can dance your head off. You can do, and you can clap. But this is for thinkers. You can't be thinking and dancing, can you? You can't be clapping and dancing and thinking. This is for thinkers. Those who are not afraid to think. You can think through it. It's a time for thinkers. I was giving a talk somewhere, and I did mention in my talk, I said, a man's enemies shall be they of his household. And one woman got up and said, you know, you're right. My enemy is my mother-in-law. She lives in my house. And I told my husband, let this man go away, and he has refused. And I said, wonderful. So your household is your home, your material home, physical home, where your mother-in-law is your enemy. You better go and change your thoughts. That's not your enemy. The Bible says it's not what you take in that defiles you. It's what comes out of your mind. Your thinking, that's your enemy. That's your greatest enemy. If you think good thoughts, your experience will be good. If you think evil thoughts, your experience will be evil. We need to wake up. I'm very fussy about that spiritual awakening. When we come to understand who God is and who we are as his reflection. And this reflection has nothing to do with our colors. A white man is God's reflection. A black man is God's reflection. A short man is God's reflection. A very tall man is God's reflection. What is God? Think about that. So if you think you are black or green or cream, I don't know what color I have. I don't care. I don't care. That has nothing to do with me. My real identity is spiritual. And so if we have the thought that makes us feel, oh, so little, because you are black, or because you are green, or because... No, you need to correct that thought. If anyone looks at you according to your color, that person is mistaken, isn't he? Yes, because the Bible says, henceforth know we no man after the flesh. Christ is incorporeal, and that's your true identity. And that's what heals you. That's what helps you. The scientific fact is that health is natural with all of us. Health is a fact for all of us. Nothing can touch your real health because it's God-derived. If anything must touch you, it must touch God first. Do you realize that? A friend of mine had a sickness that the doctors thought he couldn't make it. But he had this little understanding of Christian Science, and he said, if you say I will die, then God, the original, must die first. So if God will not die, then I will not die. And he's alive today because he knew the truth about himself. God is your life. God is the only life, and life is deathless. Don't ever give in to death. Many of us give in to death. Oh, I'm going to die. People say it. Oh, I think it's over now. When I woke up one day from a very nasty dream, nightmare, that told me I was dying, what did I do? I woke up and said, no, not me. I cannot die. But many people say, this is the dream I had. It says I'm going to die. So you start getting ready. No, I'm not going to get ready for death. No, 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 that's not my friend. Life is my friend. I'm ready for life. So you have to claim what you want to experience. Any attempts to heal the body without healing the thought will be like trying to correct a child's mistake. If a child writes on the blackboard, 2 + 5, 2 + 2 = 5. Where do you correct the mistake? Do you? Yeah, it's in his thought. So that's where you correct it. Not by blaming the blackboard. Why should you say 2 + 2? It's a mental thing. Every disease is mental. Everything we're going through is mental. And a change of thought through spiritualization of character is what brings the healing. Everything is mental. This was proved in the case of a young baby, a newborn baby. I'd worked with a mother during the pregnancy, and she had this lovely baby. I went to visit in the hospital because it was compulsory to go to hospital back home. So the baby, very beautiful and nice baby. And we left. Then the next day, the dad called me. Oh, we are losing this baby. And I said, who says that? He said, that's what the doctor said. I said, no. Whose report are you going to believe? What type of God are you serving? So I said, please come get me. I need to go and speak with that child. So I got there. This child was already screened off under blue light, and they said it was a hopeless situation. But I don't believe in hopelessness. Do you believe in hopelessness? No, no, no. I know the God I am serving. I know him. I know I can vouch for him. So I went there and I said, can I have a little time with this baby? And the nurses were saying, were asking the mother, I hope this one is not insane. What does she want to say to this little child? But at least they allowed me. And I told the little baby, I said, you better wake up. Wake up young and go home. You represent eternal life. And you have the strength of the Almighty behind you. We need you here. God is good. God is your life. Nothing is happening to you. What is jaundice? It's about blood, but you are not blood. You are not all the material elements. And I spoke with this child, and she listened to me. And the next day, the test was conducted, and she was free from jaundice. I can tell you of several cases that have yielded through the absolute trust in God, in good. A friend of mine was diagnosed. She had cancer of the leg, and it had eaten into the bone and was oozing out an offensive odor. And she was a hairdresser. Several times people would come into her shop and say, oh, something is stinking here. She knew she was the one stinking, but she said, maybe a rat or something is around, you know. It was so bad. And as we were praying, you know, when we pray about issues, we must listen. Father, what do I need to know to find healing? And that's the message of that hymn, 304. Shepherd, show me how to go. I will listen for thy voice. Then I will follow and rejoice. Listening, that's the three steps to prayer. You listen. Father, God gives, you don't tell God. We are so used to telling God, please do this for me. Oh, you know, you are so good, you know. And you keep describing him the way he doesn't want, he doesn't know all those things. You just acknowledge the truth about God. So, listen, learn to listen. Master the art of listening. Then follow, obey the ideas that come to you. And then be grateful, even before the healing. Listening, obeying, and rejoicing. Three steps to prayer. Many, we think we should inform God. God, you know what I'm going through. You know. I'm sure you do. But just come and relieve me. I just want to get out of this nonsense, you know? That's why our prayers are not being answered. We pray and receive not because we pray amiss. We need to learn how to pray. The true key to prayer is listening. Listening for ideas. And when the ideas come, you don't question them. That's what happened to me. When I needed a healing and I was praying, the idea came that I should do something, and I said, this can't be from God. No. No, 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 no. Give me another answer. So I kept listening. I kept listening. But the idea kept coming until I was willing to obey. And just that obedience led to my healing. Listen, follow, rejoice. So this young baby was healed immediately. Even my friend, when the idea came, meekness. How many people know the meaning of meekness here? What's the meaning of meekness? That's not it. It's part of it. But that's not the true meaning, the spiritual meaning. You must know how to use your dictionaries, you know? Yes. There are several meanings there. You are the one to listen, What is the real meaning? That when I teach my students now, they tell you, oh, it's not that. Because they have taught them to know. When you read, you will know the spiritual meaning. Meekness. Enduring injury with patience and without resentment. That's meekness. Check your Webster's dictionary. Enduring injury with patience and without resentment. That's meekness. That is the spiritual meaning of meekness. It's there in the dictionary. Merriam-Webster's dictionary. I have a copy in my room now. Yes. Enduring injury with patience and without resentment. So how could we relate resentment with, you know, there is no single case of cancer that have come to my knowledge that have not been healed when the person was willing to be meek. Because it's usually unforgiveness. Cancer is unforgiveness. Bitterness. You are bottling up all this anger, all this bitterness. Oh, I've forgiven, but I cannot forget. Okay, let them just go their way. Yes. And I tell you, forgiveness is so important to healing. If there's anything you are trying to heal and it's not yielding, try forgiveness. Gain a better understanding of forgiveness. And you'll be surprised how potent forgiveness is. My friend was so bitter with her husband who had hurt her. And so she couldn't get over it. When she gradually started to forgive, the wound was healed, the bone grew back, and you can't see a sign of the cancer today. She loves to wear short dresses, minis. She can now do that. Yes, she does that and you can't see the difference. I've had cases of breast cancer. It's always because someone is hurting inside, you know? You know the research that was conducted in, I think it was in the US, where someone was made very angry and the sweat was put into a chicken and the sweat killed the chicken. If the sweat cannot kill you immediately, it's going to do something to you. So, don't allow yourself to be angry with anyone. Forgive. Forgive. Learn how to forgive. Forgiveness is like when you're going on the street and you see the violet and you decide, I'm going to crush this violet. Or you kill the violet. And then you enter the next place and they say, oh, what perfume did you put on? I said, no, I didn't put on it. The violet has given you perfume for crushing it. Has done good to you. Instead, it says, do good to them that despitefully use you. No matter how long that situation has gone, no matter how serious it is, you put in that oil of forgiveness. Refusing to accept that a child of God can hurt you, or that you as a child of God can be hurt. There was a time I developed some very terrible rashes and one of my eyes couldn't open. You know, I had a very terrible, terrible boil there. And I was asking myself, what do I need to know? I had to forgive a very good friend. I got so irritated with this friend that I didn't even want to talk to her. It was not in the days of cell phones, so it was land phones, you know. And I said, listen, I don't want to. Once they mentioned her name, I said, no, I don't want to talk to her. But when this rash, very embarrassing, I couldn't come out again. It was itchy, it was everything. And I couldn't open one of my eyes. When I realized that I cannot be an irritated mortal, and I will not see an irritating mortal, I saw the man of God's creating. Against the correct view, Jesus beheld in science the perfect man, where sinning mortal man appears to mortals. When I could forgive, honestly forgive, I was healed without. Nothing remained. Everything disappeared. And this friend saved me from a great trouble some years later. She was the only one I could see. You can imagine, I wouldn't have seen anyone. Expressing love by loving everyone and everything helps us to demonstrate the healing effect of true forgiveness. I learned this lesson, and many people have learned it. People know, people are finding that the thinking they entertain actually determines their experience. Put that forgiveness, it's like oil. It's like your car needs some, the wheels need to be oiled. And you say, no movement. When it moves, I'll put oil. When this car moves, I put oil. No, forgive first. Love first. Charity begins at home, in your own consciousness. This is not just theory. In Christian Science alone, thousands, hundreds of thousands of people are finding that they need to forgive, and they're finding the effect. In a book, A Century of Christian Science Healing, a man writes of being healed of inoperable, quick-growing cancer after he turned to Christian Science for help and began to learn that God is love, loving him and loving the universe. His testimony continues, "I pondered these things over a period of months and grew continually stronger. I started to reverse every unloving thought I had about people. Loving our neighbors too selfish as God's reflection resolves all relationship problems." We need to forgive. There is one thing also that I have learned, and a lot of Christian Scientists are not awake to it, but we have to wake up to it. Reversing thought. How many people know how to reverse? You know, that was the most difficult thing for me when I was learning how to drive, you know? Yeah, reversing my car, you know? After a while, that was the only reversing I knew about. Back my car into the garage. Yes, it was easy. It became easy at a point. But what is reversal in Christian Science? What is reversal? I later learned that scientific reversal isn't about making a car go backward, but it does turn thought around and point it in a spiritual direction instead of a material one. We need to know how to reverse every unloving thought we have about people. And we have to do this consistently. Many of us would, I've reversed the thought, and you stop there. You must reverse until you arrive as a child of God. Until you can see correctly. Recently, one of my sons was very sick, and I was very honest about it. I said, I can't pray for this guy. Because before he fell ill, he went to Poland, and before he left, we had a terrible problem together. And I said, you can just go out of my life. So when they called me that he was in serious trouble, I realized I couldn't pray for him. I just said to his wife, I said, please, let me just engage a practitioner. Because I couldn't see this, I couldn't pray for him. I'm sorry, I couldn't, you know. Because each time I was trying to pray, the thought would come, he did this, he did that, you know. And then I just stopped and said, I think this guy deserves all this suffering. Yeah, let me just leave him alone, you know. It was so difficult for me. And I don't deceive myself. I wouldn't take such a case and say, I'm working for him, you know. That would be killing him. I knew I couldn't help him. So I engaged a practitioner to pray for me, to pray with me, and to help me to lift up my thought so that I can lift him up too. I needed to see him right. I needed to lift up the Son of Man, the Son of God. As Moses lifted the serpent in the wilderness, I needed to see him in his correct identity. It was difficult. But I had a good practitioner who supported me, and gradually I was able to, at least to a level, talk to him, you know. Because when he called me for the first time, Mom, I'm better, I said, I don't care. I said, what has that got to do with me? I don't care if you are better or not, that's your business. I just cut off the phone. He called back again. I'm now at home, I'm well. And I said, I don't care. What has that got to do with me? That's not that with your family, you know. It's not easy to reverse every unloving thought. the buck stops with you. You are the one to make that reversal. The Bible provides illustrations of what happens when thought turns around in broad terms. It is a record of the revelation of spiritual verities and their relevance to human experience. Only by turning sharply from the mortal sense of self, wherein material beliefs seem convincing, can we discern the child of God to whom spiritual verities are natural. It's not easy, but we have to do it. We have to do it continually, persistently, and consistently. Until we get to the point when we can see only the perfect image, until we can see the perfect child of God, until that's all we are seeing. If you are still seeing, oh, he's a child of God, but he's a perfect child of God, but if there's any but, you're still not there yet. That's what Elisha was able to prove. Yes, when the host of Syria camped around them. He didn't just tell the servant, oh, you're okay, that's okay, and don't worry, all is well. He prayed and said, Father, open his eyes. Our prayers should always be, open thou my eyes, Father, that I may see what you're seeing. What is God seeing or knowing about that individual? That's what heals. When you know the truth about every situation, when you see what God is seeing, nothing can stop you from demonstrating perfection. Reversal doesn't just turn thought back to front or upside down, all on the same human level. Reversal means shifting thought from a material basis to a spiritual one and continuing to do this until the irreversible truth of being is reached at every point. Until you attain the selfhood, the Christ, until you get to the Christhood of everyone. That's what reversal is. It's not enough to say, oh, it's not true. It's a lie, you know. It's not. That's not it. Until you can be sure within you that man is not material. Man is the image and likeness of God. We need to heal the belief of vulnerability. Oh, that one is hopeless. There is no hopelessness. In love, in God, there is no hopelessness. We can know that. And there is no hereditary law. There is nothing like that. The only father you have is God, Spirit. There is nothing that runs in your family. People say, oh, my mom died of cancer, so I must die of it. Now, this one, you know, there's nothing like that. Most of us accept unjust laws. We need to know how to reject that. If you really believe in the Christ, you will know that with God, all things are possible. Christian Science teaches that it does not matter what the type of disease is or for how long it's been going on, you can awake to God's healing law and find freedom. You can come to the Christ today. That is, awake to your true selfhood. Accept the truth about yourself as a reflection of the one perfect mind, Spirit. You should be able to leave or lay down all those false concepts. Surrender them. They don't mean anything to you. You don't need them. The teachings of Christ Jesus are available today. They're still potent. My friends, we have spent the past hour or so talking about the allness of God, Spirit, and the true nature of man as the image and likeness of God with no material aspects. We've learned how we can come to the Christ. We've learned to know that healing is mental, that every disease is mental, and a change of thought through spiritualization of character is what effects the healing. We can come to the Christ today. We realize that Christian Science is just what Jesus came to teach us, the science or understanding of the Christ or our true selfhood. My friends, regardless of what you are going through today, whether you have been bowed down by disease considered incurable or are in a situation that has persisted for many years, whatever the name or nature of the ailment, the original Christian healing, That old time religion is available. It is called Christian Science. And it can heal, it's healing, and it will heal you. Thank you.
Well, on behalf of all of us, thank you very much, Bosede. That was really, truly special. Yes, you don't have to sit down this time. That concludes our program. We thank you for coming. We're going to have tours here in the lobby with Melanie and Deborah. We have lunch in the garden. We have ice cream there. Thank you very much for coming on behalf of the board and the staff. Thank you, and have a good afternoon.